Hi, my name is Marlon and I'm from Wild Eye. I would love to chat to you more about the subject of spotlights and nighttime safaris when we're out and about in Africa and taking guests on these incredible journeys. Now, a question that's come up quite a lot on Instagram and even from guests that we take on safari is, does the light interfere with the animal and its behavior, and does it negatively affect them or impact them or harm them in any way? Now, both of these are really good questions, and I love that guests have come up to ask them, and as well as yourselves, you know, on Instagram and Facebook and YouTube. Thank you for asking these questions. That's very important, and that's why I wanted to take time and set time aside in order to answer these questions for you. So let's get straight into it and chat about why spotlights are good and when to be careful of using them and when they don't fit into the frame. We visit a lot of places in Africa. We travel all the way down from the Congo to East Africa, places like Kenya, Tanzania, and all the way down to South Africa. It's important to understand not all reserves or locations allow for the use of spotlight photography or viewing animals or predators after the cover of darkness sets in. What you need to understand is that this is mostly a Southern Africa thing. Places like Zambia, South Luangwa National Park that we visit, places in Zimbabwe, perhaps Botswana, and then South Africa. There's very few places that allow you to use spotlights or even drive in these national parks or private areas when the sun is set. Generally, you leave around sunrise, just before sunrise, and you get back to camp maybe a half an hour after sunset. So this is not a chat or a part of a safari experience that will apply to every different area. So Southern Africa in general is where you'll find it the most. I was just on safari at Malamala in the Sabisand private game reserve adjacent to the Kruger National Park in South Africa. And that was such a reserve that allowed for the viewing of animals under the cover of darkness. Now, let me tell you, it is a magnificent experience to see these animals, specifically predators, interact with each other, interact with the environment and hunt. When it is dark, it is electrifying. It is something you will never forget, okay? And that's why we do it. That's why we enjoy these night safaris or experiences when it is dark. You still have your whole full-time day. You start in the mornings. You can do lovely sunrise experiences, do the morning safari, afternoon safari. But typically what happens is as the sun starts to set, hopefully you have a lion or a leopard that you have eyes on or you've spent the afternoon with. As it starts to get dark, you get to follow them. And the spotlight aids you in that endeavor. So the fact that you can light them up, see where you're going, see where the animal's going, have eyes on prey, all of that lights up a world to our guests that they've never seen before. And even if they have, it's just such an incredible experience to be able to do that again. We see all sorts of things after dark. In addition to lion and leopard, nocturnal animals that come out that you'd never see during the day or seldom. Animals like the genet species. There's two different species of genet. Maybe you'll see bush babies. There's African wildcat, caracal if you get very, very lucky. There you get see things like hyenas, brown hyenas, spotted hyena. You can even see hippos moving about. They're quite nocturnal and very active after the sun had set. Owl species, nightjars. So there's a whole host of animals that come out once the sun has set. You know, it doesn't mean the day is now over and everyone goes to bed. There's a change. The day active animals, they go and settle in, and the nocturnal animals, they come out of crevices, bushes, shrubs, holes in trees, and then you get to see them as well. But everything has to be done to the best interest of the animals that we're viewing. And that's where this topic came up, right? That's the question on everybody's minds is how does it affect them? Does it hurt them? Does it bother them? Does it affect them hunting? Does it affect them moving? Now, one thing I'm going to say before we get into the discussion is I don't want to talk about the technical details of this. Now, there's a lot of debates around spotlights and animals' eyes and how it affects them. And, there's been research into it to some extent. I will tell you that with all the information and all the research and diving into whether it's good or bad, there's no official statement. There's no official one way of that's the way you should do it. This is how you should light them. Don't light them at all. Nothing has been put forth. So what I go on is my experience as a guide. I've been doing this for the last 15 years. And I also look at the camps we visit. These camps were established some into the 60s, the 1960s. So they have been viewing these animals under spotlight for the last 60 years, okay? Nothing has happened to those animals. Generation after generation of leopard, lion have survived, have thrived, and have entertained guests after dark for 50 or 60 years, right? So, you know, I go based on that. That's what I know. That's what I understand. That's how I viewed them. But with that comes a certain responsibility. So these animals are active after dark. Their eyes adjust to darkness. The last thing you want to be doing is taking your powerful spotlight and putting it right into the eyes of a leopard or a lion walking straight at you or on the hunt. Now, it's not good. Like that, ideally, you shouldn't be doing that. There's times when the animal is not looking directly at you, then perhaps it's fine for a photograph or a backlit scene. But overall, if the animal is moving or if it's busy hunting or if it's seen prey, don't do that. Give it a bit of space. So how we do that? How do we control this light? Well, to some extent, you can control the spotlight and make the beam wider so it's not so focused. That certainly helps. And another very easy technique is just to bounce it off the ground. So you'll shine the light into the ground. It bounces up and radiates onto the animal. You still get a great view of them, but it's not the direct light on the animal itself, which does make a difference, believe me. So what we do is exactly that. When we're viewing the animal and they're moving about, shine the light off the ground, bounce it up on them, you get a good view of them. It's not in their eyes, it's not bugging them. And to be honest, lion and leopard, these nocturnal animals, they haven't the ability, because they're day active also, they have the ability to control the amount of light coming into their eyes. They're not so sensitive, you know, to light because they're obviously active during the day also. So I've seen it for myself, you know, when you put the light on and it's a bit bright, they'll either close their eyes, shy away from the light. If you overstep and you maybe have it too bright, they'll do that. If it bugs them, what they'll also do is they'll dilate the pupil. They'll control the amount of light going into the eye. So if the spotlight's white or bright and they close their eye a little bit or allow less light in, that's their way of managing the spotlight being shone at them. You know, when we see that, we often take the light away because you know then it has bugged them. So you move it away. And, you know, it's easy for you as a viewer on social or sitting on the other side of the safari experience to see this and think, oh man, that's the light shining on the lion. That's terrible. Don't do that. But you need to understand the behind the scenes bit of it. You know, we know what we're doing and we've experienced in it. We don't want to hurt the animal. That's our last intention. I'll never push an animal beyond the ability of it to be comfortable. And you know, I don't want it to be irritated or agitated or annoyed. That's the last thing I want. I want that animal to be at its best performance, acting natural, my guest to get the full experience of what that animal would do had we not been there. You know, a light annoying the living daylights out of that animal, it's not what I want to be doing at all. So we go on, we watch the animals all, we see how it behaves, how it interacts with the light. But the great thing is these lions and leopards have for generations grown up with the light. So they're adapted to it. They're used to it. Okay, understand that. So much in the same way that we view them with the vehicle, they get used to the camera shutter, our voices, the smells, the same way they've gotten used to and habituated to the spotlight being used for first half an hour, 45 minutes, hour and a half into the evening, you know. They got the rest of the night, then they're not seen again by a game viewer. So it's only for that first hour and a bit in the evening that they ever really see a spotlight in any case. But the exciting part is when you get to follow them. So when you go out on these game viewers, now you have these lions, and to see lions during the daytime is great, but when you see them at night, that is electrifying. That is what you want to see. You want these lions awake, wide-eyed, listening, hunting, searching, smelling the air, looking for potential prey. And that is an unbelievable experience. It is something that, you know, I can't put into words, because to sit on that game viewer and be so engaged and enthralled by these ultimate apex predators all around you, right? So sometimes the spotlight's off and you just see them walking past the car, on the sides of the car, you hear their footsteps. You can't even see them sometimes when you're busy after dark. And it might sound scary, but it's not. You know, they hardly know that we're there. We're like a fly on the wall watching and consuming what they're giving us without them even knowing that we're there. They don't realize these are humans sitting on the back of this vehicle. There's a video, if you go a few episodes ago in my Instagram TV, you'll see why I talk about animals not attacking us. And it applies at night as well. Even though it's dark, they're not about to jump on the car. And it might seem, you know, why not? But it's just not what they do. They're just not used to doing that. They don't want to get on the car. For us, it's all about being there in that moment, following these lions under the dark, or a leopard. I say lions. Leopards are difficult to follow a little bit because they're single. If you keep the light on them the whole time, it's a little bit challenging, and so you don't want to disturb them too much, and they're quite solitary. You have to consider the nature of the animals. And also when a leopard hunts, if you try and watch them the whole time with a spotlight on, it's difficult and you might give their position away. And that's another thing that we do. So now we follow these lions or a leopard on the road through the bushes, and you see them hunting, stopping, listening, using their ears, and they're listening for prey. It could be for an impala. It could be for during the months of April, May, June, the impala are rutting, making a lot of noise, making a lot of sounds, and this attracts lions. And often with impala, you'll find zebra, giraffe, wildebeest, and that is what the lions want. So they know they find the impala and they find all the other game as well. So what we do then is we follow these lions and listen. You know, when they put their ears up and they're listening, we switch the car off, switch the light off, give them a chance to listen and see what's happening in their surroundings. When they start moving again, lights on, we follow. Now when they find prey, what we do is we get into the best possible position. We don't have the light on, so we don't shine the light on the subject, on the lions, we don't shine it on the prey species. So what that does is it doesn't advantage the lions and it doesn't give advantage to the prey. If we were to shine it on the prey, the lions would have the advantage and vice versa. So we want this to play out naturally. So all we do, light off, it's dark, and then you sit and wait. And this is possibly the most exciting part of it all, being there under the cover of darkness, knowing these lions are stalking all around you. And all you do is you wait, you listen for hooves running or a distress call or alarm calls. And that tells you what the lions have done. Now and again, you might check up on the lions to see that they're still there and still hunting, because it has happened that they lose interest and they disappear and you're sitting there in the darkness on your own. But for the most part, just keep tabs on them and allow them to do their thing. Lions don't have the highest success rate, maybe 3 or 4 out of 10. So often it'll be a hunt and a miss. You join the lions again. But when you hear that alarm call or the distress or the hooves running, boy, that is exciting. And you can join them then, and again, under the spotlight, see what they've caught and view them while they're busy feeding. And it's done respectfully, guys. As I said earlier, we try to keep it out of their eyes. We don't, you know, try not to shine directly into their eyes. It's great for photography, to have the spotlight around at night, but it's also great just for viewing them, being able to expose this undercover world that you don't often get to see. And that's what makes the Southern African property special, is adding these nighttime safaris to the whole experience as itself. And again, you know, there's various opinions on which color light to use and filters and all these kind of things. At the end of the day, I think it comes down to ethical values, how you control the light, being respectful to the animal. You know, a lot of places also, things to consider is when there's 2 or 3 vehicles around, often the limit within these sightings, camps that don't allow more than 3 vehicles in any one sighting, lessen the pressure on the animal itself. Now at nighttime, you don't want 3 spotlights on the animal itself. You want to minimize that. So a lot of the camps, only 1 spotlight at a time is allowed, which is great. So you have 1 spotlight, even though there's 3 cars, the other people use the spotlight from the game you're viewing at the time. And then also, when there's cubs around, be very, very sensitive to that. Many camps have policies in place that don't allow the viewing of cubs under the cover of darkness, which is brilliant, and that's exactly what you should do. You can view them by day up until 3 or 4 months of age, slowly introduce them to nighttime viewing with 1 vehicle, maybe a little bit of spotlight, and as they get older, from 6 months onwards, you introduce them to more spotlight. And again, you must understand, when you see it from the other side, it may look offensive or intrusive, but it really is not. And until you come and experience it for yourself, you'll see why. You know, these animals have been reared with the company of vehicles. That's what they know. That's what they were born with. That's what they've seen all their lives. And we make sure that we do it when we add spotlight in a sensitive manner. They mean the most to us. We want to look after them. So guys, I hope that's helped a little bit. I'm sure you'll still have questions. For those who still doubt, I'm sorry. You know, this is just a way of me trying to share a little bit more information on it to make sure that you understand what we do, why we do it, and how we do it. It's important to understand that. It's also important to have context, which I believe I've given you here. What I want you to do is leave a comment if you want. If you have more questions, again, leave it in the comment section. I'll leave an answer below. We can start maybe a bit of discussion. But I think this gives you an idea of why we do it, as mentioned earlier. But thank you for tuning in. Thank you for listening and watching this far. I hope you've learned something. Keep visiting, coming back to these pages, and I'm sure that you'll see a lot more content coming over the next couple of months. But for now, thank you for watching. Thank you for tuning in. My name is Marlon from Wild Eye. Thank you very much.